हेलो सर, गुड मॉर्निंग सर। गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल, आई एम ऑडिबल सर?
मॉर्निंग। या यस इज ऑडिबल।
ओह थैंक यू।
यस योर पीपीटी इज गॉन। इट्स शोइंग फॉर योर पीपीटी। ओके यू कैन स्टार्ट सर।
ओके सर। गुड मॉर्निंग। टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू हैंडल द यूनिट नंबर 3, मैग्नेटोस्टैटिक्स। ओके, दीज आर द टॉपिक्स आई एम गोइंग टू कवर। फर्स्ट, फोर्स ऑन अ मूविंग चार्ज। द फोर्स एक्सर्टेड ऑन अ पॉइंट चार्ज by electric and magnetic fields. Okay, charges can be stationary or in some cases it will be moving. Force that is due to electric field Fe equal to Q into E. This F denotes force and Fe denotes force due to electric field, which is nothing but Q into E, capital E. Capital E is a electric field. Then second, force due to magnetic field. Any charge that can be placed in a magnetic field, it experiences a magnetic force. So magnetic force MF equal to Q into V cross B. So static electric field E exert a force on static or moving charge Q. Thus, according to Coulomb's law, the force exerted on electric charge can be obtained. The force is related to electric field intensity, capital E, which is Fe equal to Q into E vector. Force, unit for force, Newton. For positive charge, the force exerted on it in the direction of electric field intensity E, the force is referred to as electric force, Fe. Next, now consider the charge. It is placed in steady magnetic field. It experiences the force only when it is moving. Then magnetic force exerted on a charge Q moving with velocity in steady magnetic field, it is given by Fm equal to Q V cross B. V is a velocity. Fm is a magnetic force. Unit for force, it is Newton. This is a magnetic force on a moving charge in magnetic field. This is first V, it is a velocity. Then Fm, magnetic force equal to Q into V cross B. So total force on a moving charge due to the presence of both electric field and magnetic field. So total force F equal to electric force plus magnetic force. F is electric force, Fm magnetic force. Addition of this first one, QE, which is nothing but electric force. Then second one, Fm magnetic force, QV cross B. Okay, so add the two, it results as take Q outside, E plus V cross B Newton. It's a total force. This equation we can call it as Lorentz force equation, which relates mechanical force to electric force. If M is mass of charge is M, then we can write F equal to ma. Acceleration, we can say differentiation of velocity gives acceleration. So A equal to dv by dt. So M dv by dt, which is nothing but Q into E plus V cross B Newton. Okay, as a problem, a point charge of Q minus 1.2 Coulomb as a velocity V vector equal to 5ax plus 2ay plus 3az meter per second. Find the magnitude of force exerted on the charge A. Is a given, E and B is given. E equal to minus 18 AX plus 5 AY minus 10 AZ volt per meter. Unit for electric field, it is given as volt per meter. Then B, magnetic flux density, which is given as minus 4 AX plus 4 AY plus 3 AZ. Unit is Tesla. Then third case, both are present simultaneously. Okay, so now we have to find electric force second magnetic force. Then both are present simultaneously, means we have to add the two forces, the electric force as well as the magnetic force. Okay, now first I'm calculating the electric force. You know that formula, electric force Fe equal to Q into E vector. Q, it is given as 1 minus 1.2 coulomb. So I am writing -1.2, and given E vector 5ax + 2ay - 3az. Multiply this to -1.2 into -18, which is give result as 21.6ax. -1.2 into 5, it results as -6ay. Then -1.2 into -10, it is +12az. Now we have to find the magnitude of electric force, because we are asked to find the magnitude of the force exerted on electric field, magnetic field, and combination of both. Now how to find the magnitude? You have to use the root of 21.6 whole square, then plus minus 6 whole square plus 12 whole square. Okay, where results as 25.4275 newton is a force due to electric force, magnitude of force, magnitude of electric force. Next, we are asked to find the magnitude of force exerted due to magnetic force. Formula Fm equal to Q into V cross B. You know that Q equal to -1.2, then V given as 5ax + 2ay - 3az, and B cross B -4ax + 4ay + 3az. Multiply this to -1.2 into 5, 6, -1.2 into 2, 2.4, -1.2 into -3, so this is +3.6, then -4ax + 4ay + 3az. We have to find the cross product. Okay, ax, ay, az. First, a unit vector. Second, this one -6, -2.4, 3.6. Third row, magnitude of this -4, +4, and 3. We have to find a determinant. First, ax, 3 into -2.4, 7.2, -4 into 3.6, 14.4. Here, this is plus, minus, plus. So, minus ay. Then -6 into 3, 18, minus of minus plus 4 into 3.6, 14.4, then plus az, -6 into 4, -24, minus of 4 into 2.4 is 9.6. Add this to -1.2, -14.4, -21.6 ax, then -18 plus 14.4, it is -3.6. Again into minus, it will give us +3.6 ay. Then last -24, -9.6. Addition of this gives results as -33.6 az newton. And then we are asked to find the magnitude of magnetic force. You have to find the modulus. You use root of -21.6 whole square + 3.6 square. Plus of minus 33.6 whole square. Take a root, square root, you'll get a result as modulus Fm equal to 40.1058 newton. This is a magnitude of magnetic force. Third one, total force. Formula capital F equal to Fe plus Fm, force due to electric field and force due to magnetic field. Add the two. Here 21.6 minus 21.6, so it is 0, ax. Then -6 plus 3.6, it results as -2.4 ay. Then +12 minus 33.6 gives us -21.6 az newton. At last, we have to find the magnitude of the total force equal to root of magnitude of this 0 square plus of -2.4 square plus of -21.6 whole square. And the final result what we are getting is modulus F equal to 21.7329 newton. This is a total force which is due to both electric force and magnetic force acting combinedly acting each other. Okay, next we are going to see Biot-Savart law. That is Biot-Savart law. The Biot-Savart law states that the magnetic field intensity DH produced at a point P due to differential current element, which is, that is directly proportional to product of current and differential length. We can write as directly proportional to DH directly proportional to IDL sine theta divided by R square. Okay, this is nothing but Biot-Savart law. So the magnetic DH is a differential, H means magnetic field density. So DH vector means is a differential magnetic field intensity. So produced at a point P due to differential current element is directly proportional to product of current and differential length DL, so IDL. Then next, directly proportional to sine of the angle between element and line joining the point P. Third, it is inversely proportional to square of the distance between R and point R between point P and the element. Now the Biot-Savart law, this DH vector is directly proportional to IDL sine theta by R square. Removing the proportionality, I'm going to use equal to K IDL sine theta by R square. K is a constant of proportionality. In SI units, we can substitute K equal to I by 4 pi. Substitute K equal to I by 4 pi in equation number 2, getting DH vector equal to IDL sine theta divided by 4 pi R square. DL is a magnitude of vector length DL, and R is a unit vector in the direction from differential current element to point P. Now we have to know, then by the rule of cross product, DL cross R, you know that A cross B, or A cross B is AB sin theta. Similarly here, DL cross R, DL magnitude of R sin theta. You know that magnitude of R unit vector, which is always 1. So modulus of R, which is equal to 1, we substitute here, we are getting DL sin theta. Now replace it in equation number 3. So instead of DL sin theta, in equation number, we are having DL sin theta over here. We have to use DL cross R vector for this in third equation. Now DH equal to, we know that R, so you have to find a unit vector. Unit vector R equal to vector by magnitude of vector. You can say it is a unit vector. So R divided by magnitude of R, we can use just a capital R. Now DH equal to I DL cross R divided by 4 pi R cube. Okay, before that we are having some DH equal to I DL cross AR divided by 4 pi R square. But we find out AR, unit vector equal to vector divided by magnitude of vector. So I am substituting instead of AR, R vector by capital R. So we will getting DH equal to IDL cross R divided by 4 pi R cube ampere per meter. This equation number 4 and 5, which is called as mathematical form of Biot-Savart law. Next, the total magnetic field density H, equation 4 takes integral form. Because in equation number 4, you are having finding the differential field density DH. Okay, how to find a H vector H from this fourth equation? Just you have to integrate that fourth equation. So the integration of DH, it gives us result H. Integration of DH, D and integral cancel, you will be getting H. Okay, so H equal to closed integral I DL cross AR divided by 4 pi R square. Next up, if the current element is considered at point 1, that is a current element IDL 1, and point P at point 2. This is your point P. I am considering this point 2 as shown in figure. Now we have to find a different, we are going to find the differential magnetic field density at this point number, point 2. So I have to use DH2 equal to I DL1. DL is which is present in point 1. I have to use IDL1 cross AR12 as a unit vector between this 1 and 2. Okay, we have to write as AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. The distance between point 1 and point 2, take it as R12. The distance between point 1 and 2, it is R12. So now DH2 equal to IDL1 cross AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. unit for magnetic field density, ampere per meter. This is expressed in vector form. Next, I1 is a current flowing through DL1, and DL1 differential vector length, AR12 unit vector in the direction from point 1 and to point P. Then we know that we already know that how to find the unit vector, vector divided by magnitude of vector. Here a vector, it is R12, the distance between point 1 and point 2, it is considered as R, R12, magnitude of R, this capital R12. And I'm substituting here, finding H2, that is a magnetic field density at point 2, equal to closed integral IDL1 cross ER12 divided by 4 pi R12 square ampere per meter. This is, we can call this integral form of Biot-Savart law. Okay, problem. Find the incremental field strength at P2 due to the current element of 2 pi AZ micro ampere meter at P1. The coordinates of P1 and P2 are 4, 0, 0. This is X1, Y1, Z1. Similarly here, X2, Y2, Z2 respectively. Now I'm going to plot it in a graph, that X1, Y1, Z1 and X2, Y2 and Z2. Now 4, 0, 0. Okay, this is x-axis. We know this is x-axis, y-axis and z-axis. 4, 0, 0. This is a point. 4, 0, 0. In x-axis 4, y-axis 0, z-axis 0. This is a point called P1. And point 2, x-axis 0, y-axis 3, z-axis 0. So P2 are 0, 3, 0. Now I'm going to find, use a Biot-Savart law. Formula for Biot-Savart law, DH2, result of Biot-Savart law, DH2 equal to I1 DL1 plus R12 by 4 pi R12 square. Now we have to find R12. How to find R12? This is R12, distance between this 1 and 2. So X2 minus X1 whole square plus Y, sorry, X2 minus X1 plus AX, Y2 minus Y1, AY, Z2 minus Z1, A is Z. Here, look at here, 0 minus 4, 3 minus 0, 0 minus 0. Simplify this, 0 minus 4, minus 4 AX, plus 3 minus 0, 3 AY, 0 AZ. Okay. Here to find the magnitude of R12, use root of minus 4 square plus 3 square, 4 square 16, 3 square 9, 16 plus 9, 25, root of 25, taking out of a root, it is 5. Now substitute, we have to find the AR12, unit vector AR12 equal to R12 divided by magnitude of R12. R12, it is minus 4 AX plus 3 AY, this is R12. Magnitude we already found out as 5. Substitute this R12 vector divided by R12. Now while I1 DL1, it is given as 2 pi AZ micro ampere meter. Now look at the first DH2 equal to IDL1 cross AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. First finding the cross product IDL1 cross AR12. I1 DL1 cross AR12. First row unit vector AX, AY, AZ. Second row I1 DL1. Look at here I1 DL1, it is in AZ. Okay, AZ means it is in Z direction. So 0, 0, 2 pi. You have to use 0, 0, 2 pi. Then third, minus 4 by 5 and 3 by 5. You have to write it as minus 4 by 5 AX plus 3 by 5 into AY. So minus 4 by 5, 3 by 5. There is no AZ. So you have to substitute 0. Find the determinant AX. 0, 0 into 0, 0. 3 into 2 pi, 6 pi by 5. So minus 6 pi by 5. Then this is plus, minus, plus. So minus AY, 0 minus 8 pi by 5. Okay, take minus 2 by 5 outside, 3 AX plus 4 AY. So I1 DL1. Now substitute everything, that is I1 DL1 cross AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. Okay, divided by 4 pi R12, we already found it as 5, so 5 square. cancel this 2 pi and 4 pi, getting 2. 5 square 25, 25 into 50. So 55, so getting minus 4 into 10 power minus 3. Multiplying this, minus 12 AX, minus 16 AY, nano ampere per meter. Already we are having 10 micro means 10 power minus 6. Again we are having 10 power minus 3. So 10 power minus 6 into 10 power minus 3, 10 power minus 9, which is denoted as nano ampere per meter. Okay, next. H vector, that is magnetic field density due to infinitely long straight conductor. Okay, this is an infinitely long straight conductor. This is an infinitely long straight conductor which is placed along Z axis. It carries a direct current I. This is a carries direct current I. The perpendicular distance at point P from Z axis is R. The conductor is placed in such a way that one end okay. First I am going to find a ideal equal to I into D Z A Z as the conductor which is placed along Z axis. So it can be denoted as DZ, AZ. AZ means which, the conductor which is placed along Z axis. Next, I'm going to find R12. This is a point 1. This is point 2. This is nothing but RAR vector. This is minus Z, AZ. So add this minus Z, AZ plus RAR. This is R12. Next step, we have to find a unit vector. A unit vector is AR12, which is equal to R12 divided by magnitude of R12. R12, it is RAR minus ZAZ. Magnitude means we are using root of R square plus or minus Z whole square. We are getting root of R square plus Z square. Next, DL cross AR12. DL cross, you have to find this DL cross AR12. First row, unit vector. Second row, DL. What is DL? It is DZAZ. So use 0, 0 in Z. It is DZ. Third one, R0 minus Z. Okay, because it's AR, AFI, AZ. So R0 minus Z. We are having some root of R square plus Z square. So 1 by root of R square plus Z square. Find the determinant. We are getting R, DZ, AFI divided by root of R square plus Z square. Okay, while obtaining the cross product, R12 is neglected for convenience and must be considered for further calculations. Next, IDL cross AR12 equal to IR DZ AFI divided by root of R square plus Z square. Now, according to the Biot-Savart law, differential magnetic field density at point 2, which is given as DH vector equal to IDL cross AR12 by 4 pi R12 square. Substitute this unit 4 in this equation. IR DZ AFI divided by 4 pi root of R square plus Z square. For R12, magnitude of R12, we already found out this. R12 equal to root of R square plus Z square. Substitute here. So root of R square plus Z square whole power 2. Then again further simplifying. 1 IR DZ AFI divided by 4 pi. This root of R square plus Z square can be written as R square plus Z square whole power 1 by 2. And root and square will get cancelled here. You will be getting R square plus Z square power 1. For simplifying this, 1 by 2 plus 1, it is 3 by 2. Okay, next, H can be calculated by integrating the DH over the entire length. As we are placing the conductor, infinitely long straight conductor in Z axis, going to take limit as Z equal to minus infinity to plus infinity dH. Now substitute here Z equal to integral Z equal to minus infinity to plus infinity IR dZ AFI divided by 4 pi R square plus Z square whole power 3 by 2. substitute z equal to r tan theta, find, I'm going to find z square, because as we are in EDA, in equation number 6, finding z square equal to r square tan square theta. Differentiation of this z with respect to theta gives dz equal to r is constant. Differentiation of tan theta, it is secant square theta. So dz by d theta equal to r secant square theta. Cross multiply, dz equal to r secant square theta d theta. Similarly, now substituting z equal to minus infinity. If I substitute z equal to minus infinity, so tan theta equal to minus infinity, theta equal to tan inverse minus infinity. So I'm getting tan 90, okay, right? So theta equal to minus pi by 2. Pi by 2, which is nothing but 90 degree. Next, substituting z equal to plus infinity. Substitute plus infinity, tan theta equal to plus infinity, theta equal to tan inverse infinity. Tan inverse infinity is 90 degree. So you're getting theta equal to pi by 2. Substitute is theta equal to minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Wherever z comes, here substitute r tan theta. Dz comes r secant square theta d theta. Z comes r tan theta. Z square means r square tan square theta. Substitute everything in this equation number 6. We are getting this. Next, for simplification, just take here having r square common. But r square power whole power 3 by 2, square and square, 2 to cancel. Okay, r square whole power 3 by 2, which means that these 2 to cancel, will be getting r cube. Similarly here, I r square secant square theta d theta fi divided by 4 pi r cube. Similarly here, tan square theta. Okay, 1 plus tan square theta, this secant square theta. You know that 1 plus tan square theta, which is nothing but secant square theta. Similarly here the same, secant square theta whole power 3 by 2 square square cancel, will be getting secant cube theta. Now cancelling this r square and r cube. Similarly here secant square with secant cube. So I'm getting I divided by 4 pi r. 1 by secant theta, we know that it is a cos theta d theta a phi. We are going to integrate with respect to theta. The remaining constants, it is taken out of integral. So I by 4 pi r integral minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2 cos theta d theta a phi. We know that integration of cos theta, it is plus sin theta. So sin theta minus pi by 2 plus pi by 2 a phi. Substituting upper limit minus lower limit. Upper limit sine pi by 2 minus lower limit sine of minus pi by 2. We know that sine 90 degree is 1. Sine 90 degree equal to 1. Similarly, sine of minus theta, it is minus sine theta. Okay, substituting this sine pi by 2, 1 minus sine of minus theta minus sine theta. So automatically minus 1. 1 minus of minus 1, 2. Okay, cancel this 2 with 4. I by 2 pi r a phi ampere per meter. We know that relationship between B and H, B equal to mu H. Okay, so now if I want to find B, so multiply with mu into H, I by 2 pi r a phi ampere per meter. Okay, next. Next topic, H vector due to strike conductor of finite length. Okay, in the previous derivation, we have used infinitely long strike conductor, which is based along z axis. So we have to take the integral as z equal to minus infinity to plus infinity. That's an infinitely long strike conductor. But now we are going to see the strike conductor of finite length. Now consider a differential element dl along z axis at a distance z from origin. Here also, dl equal to dz az, because we are placing the conductor on z axis. Next, unit vector in the direction joining the differential element to point P, the same ar12 equal to r12 divided by magnitude of r12, which is equal to rar minus zaz divided by root of r square plus z square. Okay, next dl cross ar12, 1 by root of, because we are having ar12, which is nothing but vector divided by magnitude of vector, this is nothing but R A R minus Z A Z divided by root of R square plus Z square. Finding dl cross A R, first row unit vector, A R A F I A Z. A R A F I A Z. Second row dl. As it is placed on Z axis, you are having D Z A Z. So 0 0 D Z. Third row A R vector, it is R 0 minus Z. So 1 by root of R square plus Z square. Finding here A R 0 minus 0 0. Then minus A F I 0 into minus Z 0. Then minus R D Z. Third plus A Z 0 minus 0. Minus into minus plus, so R D Z A F I divided by root of R square plus Z square. Now I'm going to find this IDL cross AR 12. Equal to IR DZ AFI divided by root of R square plus Z square. Next, according to Biot-Savart law, DH at point P equal to IDL cross AR 12 divided by 4 pi R 12 square. We already find out IDL cross AR 12. Substitute here IDL cross AR 12, which is nothing but IR DZ AFI by root of R square plus Z square. Divided by 4 pi R12 square. So 4 pi R12 is root of R square plus Z square whole square. The same, this is a root of R square plus Z square, which can be written as R square plus Z square whole power 1 by 2. Similarly here, root of R square plus Z square whole square. Root of R square plus Z square whole square, which can be written as R square plus Z square. R square plus Z square. 1 plus 1 by 2, it is 3 by 2. 4 pi R square plus Z square whole power 3 by 2. Next, total H at P due to
sir, sorry, Saran, sir. Hello. Sir, sorry, Saran, sir.
Sir. Tower problem, sir. 1 minute, sir.
Okay. Hello.
It's a connecting sir.
சார் கனெக்ட் ஆகலைங்களா சதீஸ்வரன் சார் ஹலோ
சார் கனெக்ட் பண்ணிட்டு இருக்கேன் சார் 1 மினிட் சார்
screen visible ah
okay share aichinga ppt matum konjam big size la okay yes sari sir
okay, okay. Sir. Sorry sir, technical issues sorry.
Okay
root of r square plus z square whole power 1 by 2 into root r square plus z square power 1 it gives us r square plus z square power 3 by 2 so now dh equal to ir dz a phi divided by 4 pi r square plus z square whole power 3 by 2 as the conductor a finite length it is placed on z equal to 1 and z equal to 2 so total h at p due to conductor of finite length can be obtained by integrating dh over z equal to z1 to z equal to z2 now h equal to integral z1 to z2 dh equal to so ir dz a phi divided by 4 pi r square plus z square whole power 3 by 2 now substitute r equal to tan alpha sorry z equal to tan alpha r tan alpha finding z square r square tan square alpha then differentiation of z dz gives us r differentiation of tan theta tan square so dz equal to r secant square alpha d alpha first we are placing the conductor z equal to z1 to z equal to z2 substitute here z1 equal to r tan alpha 1 alpha 1 equal to tan z1 by r similarly z2 equal to r tan alpha 2 alpha 2 equal to tan inverse z2 divided by r now h can be find out by integrating this into alpha 1 to alpha 2 so h equal to integration of alpha 1 to alpha 2 I r z equal to sorry dz equal to r secant square alpha d alpha a phi divided by 4 pi r square for z square r square tan square alpha power 3 by 2 the same r square whole power 3 by 2 it gives us cancel 2 into will getting r cube so 4 pi r cube alpha simplifying this r square and r cube will getting r so take I by 4 pi r outside integral alpha 1 to alpha 2 1 by secant alpha we know that cos alpha so cos alpha d alpha a phi integration of cos it is sin alpha so sin alpha alpha 1 to alpha 2 a phi so now h equal to I by 4 pi r sin upper limit minus lower limit substituting upper limit sin alpha 2 minus sin alpha 1 a phi ampere per meter similarly b can be find out by using b equal to mu h multiplying mu in the h will be getting b so final b equal to mu I by 4 pi r sin alpha 2 minus sin alpha 1 a phi weber per meter square the sign convention of alpha 1 and alpha 2 suppose if you are placing the finite conductor on both the positive axis that is above point p okay, if the both the end of the conductors are above point p then alpha 1 and alpha 2 are positive the next if both the end of the conductors are below okay here look at here this is a both the end 1 and 2 which is below the point p it can be taken as negative one end is above point P and one end is below point P. We can write alpha 1 is negative and alpha 2 is positive for this. Okay, next one. What you are going to is a H magnetic field at the center of a circular conductor. Okay, consider a current carrying conductor arranged in circular form as shown in figure. The h at the center of the circular loop is to be obtained the conductor carries direct current i consider differential length is a differential length dl at point 1 is the direction of dl at point 1 is tangential to the circular conductor at point 2 so this is tangential then theta it is a angle between idl and AR12. AR12, which is nothing but unit vector in the direction of R12. This is R12, which is nothing but the distance between distance vector joining differential current element at point 1 to point P at point 2, which is the center of the circle. So using the definition of cross product, ideal cross AR12, we know that A cross B equal to AB cos theta, same ideal AR12 sin theta AN. A cross B is AB sin theta. Okay, now magnitude of DL, it is DL vector. Magnitude of AR12, we know that magnitude of unit vector is always 1. That is magnitude AR12, which is nothing but 1. So IDL vector sin theta into AN. AN is a unit vector normal to the plane containing DL and AR12. According to Biot-Savart law, ideal cross AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. Substitute here DL cross AR12. I already found out ideal cross AR12. Substitute here IDL sin theta AN divided by 4 pi R square. The total magnetic field density at point P obtained by integrating DH around the circular closed path. Just integration of DH, closed integral IDL sin theta AN by 4 pi R square. As we are going to integrate with respect to DL, so take remaining parameters outside. So I sin theta AN divided by 4 pi R square outside. Closed integral DL, we know the circumference of a circle, which is 2 pi R. Substitute here integration DL, instead of integral DL, you have to substitute 2 pi R. So 2 pi R I sin theta 2 pi R AN divided by 4 pi R square. Okay, cancel this 2 pi and 2 pi, the 4 pi, getting 2. So I sin theta by 2 R into AN. As ideal is a tangential to the circle and R12 is a radius, angle must be 90 degrees. So if you substitute angle 90 degree, sin 90, it is 1. So I by 2 R AN, A by M. We know that B equal to mu H, mu equal to mu naught into mu R. Relative permeability equal to 1. We'll be getting B equal to mu naught H. So I want to find B, multiply mu naught into H. So mu naught H is given by I by 2 R AN. So unit for B, it is Weber per meter square or Tesla. Okay, next. H on axis of circular loop. That is magnetic field density on the axis of circular loop. First here, consider a circular loop carrying a direct current I placed in XY plane with the Z axis as shown in figure. The magnetic field intensity H at point P is to be obtained. The point P is at distance Z from the plane of circular loop along axis. The radius of a circular loop, it is R. Okay, this is the radius of a circular loop, it is R. Consider the differential length DL of circular loop as shown in figure. Now, in cylindrical coordinate system, the differential length is dr, er vector, dr, r, d phi, and dz. Okay. By using the cylindrical coordinate system, dl equal to dr, er vector plus r, d phi, a phi vector plus dz, az vector. Now, dl is in a plane for which r is constant. So, we have to use a d, z equal to 0 is a constant plane. Ideal is a tangential at point 1 in A phi direction. Okay, so only you will be getting only this R D phi A phi. So ideal equal to I into R D phi A phi. As it is a constant, just if substituting Z equal to 0, you won't getting DZ. Similarly, R is constant, so automatically this will become 0. So it will become ideal equal to IR D phi into A phi. Unit vector is R12 divided by magnitude of R12. Okay, R12 is the distance vector. This can be find out by using this diagram. This is minus R AR plus Z AZ from 1 to 2. So So modulus of R12 equal to root of R square minus R whole square plus Z whole square, which is equal to root of R square plus Z square. ER12 is unit vector, vector divided by magnitude of vector. Vector, this is your vector, minus R ER plus Z A Z. Magnitude of vector, root of R square plus Z square. The substitute vector and magnitude of vector. Now the next point, we have to find DL cross ER12. First row unit vector, second row DL, 0 R D5, 0. Third row, this is minus R, 0 Z into 1 by root of R square plus Z square. I find the determinant, we'll be getting DL cross AR12 equal to 1 by root of R square plus Z square into ZR D5 AR vector plus R square AZ D5 D5 AZ vector. According to Biot-Savart law, DH equal to ideal cross AR12 divided by 4 pi R12 square. Substitute this ideal cross AR12, and we know that R12 we already find out as root of R square plus Z square. Okay, root, then R square means root of R square plus Z square whole square. Now H vector, this can be find out by using just a integration. Okay, integration, there is a integration of DH results as H vector. Now H vector equal to integral pi equal to 0 to 2 pi I into ZR D5 AR plus R square D5 AZ divided by 4 pi R square plus Z square whole power 3 by 2. Just going to split the integral into 2, I by 4 pi, integral pi equal to 0 to 2 pi, splitting this integral into 2 integrals. Next, the value of the first integral is 0 due to radial symmetry. So it can be treated as 0 because of the radial symmetry condition. Next, the second, h equal to I by 4 pi integral pi equal to 0 to 2 pi r square d phi divided by r square plus z square whole power 3 by 2. Okay. As we are integrating with respect to d phi, take the remaining parameter outside of the integral. So I r square a z divided by 4 pi r square plus z square whole power 3 by 2. Integration of d phi, already told the integration differential, it cancels, you'll be getting only pi. Substituting the limit, upper limit is 2 pi, lower limit is 0, you'll be getting only 2 pi. Cancelling this 2 pi with 4 pi, you'll be getting 2. So I r square divided by 2 into r square plus z square whole power 3 by 2 into a z ampere per meter. R is a radius of circular loop, I is a distance of point P along axis. So now H equal to I into R square divided by 2 R cube AZ. Substituting Z equal to 0. Okay. Z equal to 0. Point P shifted to the center of the circular loop, which means that Z equal to 0. You substitute Z equal to 0 in this seventh equation, we'll be getting I R square divided by 2 into R square power 3 by 2, cancel square square, you'll be getting cube. So cancel this R square and cube, will be getting I by 2R into AZ ampere per meter. This is a magnetic field at the center of circular loop. Okay, next, coming to the next topic, it is ampere circuit law. What is ampere circuit law? Line integral. Okay, H dot, H vector dot DL equal to I. Okay, so line integral of magnetic field intensity around a closed path is exactly equal to direct current enclosed by the path, which is nothing but ampere circuital law. The proof of ampere circuital law: consider DL at point P, which is in FI direction, tangential to circular path at P. Now DL equal to R D phi FI. Biot-Savart law, due to infinitely long side conductor, result of that is H equal to I by 2 pi R FI. Finding the H vector dot DL vector. DL is nothing but R D phi. So now cancel this RR, it give result as I by 2 pi into D5. We know that FI dot FI equal to 1. The same I dot I equal to 1, J dot J, K dot K, K like that, FI dot FI equal to 1. Okay, so we're getting I by 2 pi into D5. This is H dot DL. Now I'm going to integrate H dot D dl over the entire closed loop. So integration of HRDL equal to integral 0 to 2 pi I by 2 pi into d phi. Take I by 2 pi outside. Integration of d phi, it results as pi. This is wrong. Integration of d phi, it is pi 0 to 2 pi. 2 pi minus 0. So 2 pi, 2 pi cancel. So you'll be getting integration of HRDL equal to I. Okay, that is line integral of magnetic field density around a closed path is exactly equal to direct current enclosed by the path. Next, application of Ampere circuit law. H due to infinitely long straight conductor. Here consider the elementary length dl at point P, and in cylindrical coordinates it is r d phi in a phi direction. So h equal to h pi a phi, dl equal to r d phi a phi. Finding dot product h vector dot dl equal to substituting h pi a phi into r d phi a phi, a phi dot a phi 1, so we'll be getting h pi r d phi. So h dot dl equal to h pi into r d phi. According to Ampere circuit law, flow integral h vector dot dl equal to I. Substituting h and dl, h dot dl, that is h pi r d phi equal to I. I'm going to integrate with respect to d phi. H pi r, take h pi r out of integral. So h pi dot r integral pi equal to 0 to 2 pi d phi equal to I. Integration of d phi SSS pi 0 to 2 pi. So we'll be here, we'll be getting 2 pi. H pi equal to I by 2 pi r. Hence h at point P is given by h equal to h pi a phi. So now h vector equal to, this is your h pi, you multiply with a phi. This is nothing but magnetic field intensity. H equal to I by 2 pi r a phi ampere per meter. Okay, next we are going to find a magnetic field density due to a coaxial cable. A magnetic field density due to a coaxial cable. First, region 1, I'm going to within the inner conductor. Okay, that is R less than A. Okay, this is R, this is A, this is the first region. R less than A, consider a closed path having radius R less than A. Hence, it encloses only a part of the conductor. The area of a cross section, it is pi r square. Okay, area of a circle, you know that area of the circle is pi r square, square meter. So square meter is your meter square. This is written in meter square. Next, the total current flowing through area pi a square. Hence, current enclosed by the path I dash equal to pi r square divided by pi a square into I. Cancel pi and pi, getting r square divided by a square into I. Next, h is again only in pi direction, depends only on r. So h bar equal to h pi a phi. Then dl, it is r d phi a phi. Okay, consider dl in a phi direction, which is something but r d phi a phi. Finding h dot dl, answer is h dot dl equal to h pi into r d phi. According to Ampere circuit law, closed integral h dot dl equal to I dash. Okay, now substituting this I dash, it is nothing but r square by a square into I. Taking h pi r outside, integration of d phi, it results as pi. Okay, integration of d phi results as pi. Substitute 0 to 2 pi. So 2 pi minus 0 equal to r square by a square into I. I want to find only h pi. So 2 pi r, it will come to the denominator. R square I by a square into 2 pi r. Cancel this r square and r. Getting IR divided by 2 pi a square. H equal to h pi a phi. Now h means multiply with this h pi with a phi, getting this magnetic field intensity. This is for region 1. For region 2, with a, that is r is between a and b. Okay, if r is between a and b, the consider a circular path which encloses the inner conductor carrying the direct current I. This is the case of infinitely long conductor along z axis. H equal to I by 2 pi r a phi ampere per meter. third one region 3 within outer conductor B less than C, B to C. This R is between B and C. So now the total current minus I flowing through the cross section, it is pi into C square minus B square. While the current closes the cross section, pi into R square minus B square. Now substituting these two, I dash equal to pi into R square minus B square divided by pi into C square minus B square into minus I. Cancel this pi, pi will be getting minus R square minus B square divided by C square minus B square into I. Now this I dash double dash equal to I, which is nothing but current in the inner conductor enclosed. So now the total conductor enclosed by the path, add the two currents I dash and I double dash. Take I outside, we'll be getting 1 minus R square minus B square divided by C square minus B square. Cross multiply C square minus B square minus R square plus B square divided by C square minus B square. Cancel this minus B square and plus B square. We'll be getting I into C square minus R square by C square minus B square. This is the total current enclosed by the path. Now, according to the Ampere circuit law, closed into H radial equal to I enclosed. Now, again, H is again in FI direction only. And this function of R only. So now H equal to H by FI, DL equal to R D by FI. Finding H dot DL, the same will be getting H by R D pi. Integrate substitute here. Integration pi equal to 0 to 2 pi, H by R D pi equal to I enclosed. Integration of D pi results as pi. So we'll be getting 2 pi R. H pi equal to I by 2 pi R into C square minus R square by C square minus B square ampere per meter. Then last, outside the cable, say R greater than C, consider the closed path with R greater than C such that it is closed both the conductors plus I, both currents, that is plus I and minus I, total current equal to zero because first plus I minus I gives us I minus I equal to zero. Now closing the radial equal to zero. As Ampere's equal to H equal to 0. This is for R greater than C. Now look at in the diagram. We can find the variation of H against R in the coaxial cable. Okay, this is nothing but the region 4. If it is outside the cable, we'll be getting a value 0. Okay, next, curl of the vector field. In general, curl of the vector field is another field. That is normal to original field. Curl H n equal to limit del S n tends to 0 close integral H dot dl divided by del S n. Then curl in the three coordinate system. First rectangular coordinate system, curl equal to dou H z by dou y minus dou H y by dou z into AX. Look at here, this is a y z, zx. XY. Okay, YZ means X. ZX means Y. XY is Z. Okay, we'll come like that. Easiest way to calculate this, curl H, first row unit vector, second row dou by dou X, dou by dou Y, dou by dou Z, third row magnitude of HX, HY, HZ. So we can write this curl H, which is nothing but del cross H. Then curl in other coordinate system. This is cylindrical and this is a spherical coordinate system. Then Stokes theorem. What's the Stokes theorem? Line integral of the magnetic field intensity. Okay, that is a closed integral. H dot dl equal to integral del cross H into ds. Okay, line integral which is to be converted into surface integral, or in other words, single integral which can be converted into a double integral with the help of theorem called as Stokes theorem. So in the closed integral, H dot dl equal to integral del cross H into ds. Okay, next, magnetic flux and flux density. The relation between B and H, which is through the property of medium called a permeability mu. B equal to mu H. For free space, mu naught equal to 4 pi into 10 power minus 7 mu r. Relative permittivity is mu r. For free space, B equal to mu naught H. Then phi equal to B dot integral S B dot ds. This is a magnetic flux. In the case of electric flux, psi equal to D dot ds. Okay, next, phi means magnetic flux in Weber, B magnetic flux density in Weber per meter square or Tesla, ds is open surface through which flux is passing. Next, the integral b dot ds is evaluated over closed integral. Closed integral s b dot ds equal to zero. This equation we can call it as a law of conservation of energy or Gauss law in integral form for magnetic fields. Apply divergence theorem. Divergence theorem, it is used to convert surface integral into volume integral, or in other words, double integral into triple integral. Integral v dot ds, it is equal to integral v del dot v dv. Okay, even if you use integral v, which is nothing but triple integral here. Similarly, integral s, which denotes this is a double integral. Okay, so double integral is to be converted into triple integral, or in other words, surface integral can be converted into volume integral by means of theorem called as Gauss divergence theorem. So applying theorem. Next, it is equal to zero. Both the sides are having volume. Cancel this volume. Volume will getting del dot b equal to zero. Dv cannot be zero, so automatically del dot b equal to zero. So divergence of magnetic field density is always zero. Dot means divergence. So del dot b means divergence of b means magnetic flux density. So divergence of magnetic flux density is zero. This is called as Gauss law in differential form for magnetic field. This is another Maxwell's equation. Now let us see the what are the Maxwell's equation. First, Maxwell's equation for static fields. The del dot d equal to rho v. This is nothing but Gauss law for electric field. Then del cross e equal to zero. This is conservation property of static electric field. Then Ampere's equator law. Del cross H equal to J. Then fourth one, del dot B equal to zero. This is Gauss law for magnetic field. Then coming to the integral form, integral S D dot ds equal to integral V rho V dV. Then next, integral E dot dl equal to zero. Integral H dot dl equal to integral J dot ds equal to E. The last one, closed integral B dot ds equal to zero. These are the Maxwell's equation. So there totally there are four Maxwell's equation which is derived from Gauss law for electric field, Gauss law for magnetic field, Ampere's equator law, okay. Coming to the magnetic boundary condition, the condition exists at the boundary between two media. We can call it as magnetic boundary conditions or boundary conditions for magnetic field. Here, consider an interface between two media having different permeabilities, say mu1 and mu2. We want to find the relationship between the magnetic fields at boundary. This is done by considering separately the normal and tangential. There are two components. One is a tangential component, another one is a normal component. Look at here, this is a boundary between two magnetic materials of different permeabilities. Okay, if you take an electrical boundary condition, it will be between two permittivities, say epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. But here, it's a magnetic boundary condition. So, between two different permeabilities, mu 1 and mu 2. Now, we are going to take a right circular cylinder. This is a tan means tangential component, which is parallel to the boundary, and n is a normal component which is perpendicular to the boundary. If we take, if you are having some B as well as H, or H also, H means magnetic field intensity. Here also the two component, one is a normal component and the tangential component. Okay, the conditions of magnetic field exist at the boundary between two media, where the magnetic field passes from one medium to another medium are called boundary conditions for magnetic field. Okay, first the boundary conditions for normal component. To find the normal component of B, first select a Gaussian surface in a form of right circular cylinder. Height of the cylinder del H, which is and be placed in such a way that one half is in medium one and another half is in medium two. Also, the axis of cylinder is normal in direction to the surface. According to the Gauss law for magnetic field, closed integral is B dot ds equal to zero. Okay, this is a Gauss law for magnetic field. So the surface integral must be evaluated over three surfaces. If we take a cylinder, there are three surfaces: top surface, bottom surface, and lateral surface. So separating the closed integral into three integral: open integral, integral top B dot ds, integral bottom B dot ds, integral lateral B dot ds equal to zero. As we are going to concentrate only on the boundary between two surfaces, I am considering the del H, the lateral surface, del H equal to zero. For top surface, integral top B dot ds. For top, this is a perpendicular to the boundary, so it can be called as a normal component. While taking out of integral, take B n one into del S means small surface integral. So B n one del S. Next, coming to the bottom surface, B n two integral is bottom ds del S. So B n two del S. For lateral surface, I am taking equal to zero because we are concentrating only on the boundary. Considering del H equal to zero, automatically lateral surface will become zero. The one thing we have to keep it in mind: one side flux is entering, other side it is leaving. Suppose if you are considering that BN1, okay, it is going inside, flux is inside in one boundary, for another side it is out. Okay, so BN1 and BN2 are always in opposite direction. Okay, because one side flux is passing, another side leaving. One side entering, another side leaving. Okay, it will vice versa. So when you are taking BN1 as positive, you have to take BN2 as a negative. Suppose if you are taking BN1 as negative, BN2 as a positive, because both are in opposite direction. Okay, so now substitute here BN1 del S minus BN2 del S equal to zero. First, in a BN1 is entering, N2 is leaving. So BN1 del S minus BN2 del S equal to zero. Take del S outside. So BN1 del S equal to BN2 del S. Cancel del S del S. BN1 equal to BN2. Thus, normal component of B is continuous at the boundary. Now substituting B equal to mu H. So mu1 HN1 equal to mu2 HN2. Substitute here HN1 by HN2 equal to mu2 by mu1. Mu2 equal to mu0 mu R2. Similarly, mu1 equal to mu0 mu R1. Cancel mu0 mu0. You'll be getting is M mu R2 divided by mu R1. Now here, hence normal component of H is not continuous at the boundary. Okay, but here normal component of B, it is continuous at the boundary between two surfaces or two media. Next, going to find a boundary conditions for a tangential component. According to the Ampere's circuital law, integral H dot dl equal to I. So for a rectangular path, if we taking, it is traced in clockwise direction. Put here. Okay, this is A, B, C, D, A. Okay, so it can be written as integral A to B plus integral B to 2 plus integral 2 to C plus integral C to D plus integral D to 1 plus integral 1 to A. Okay, this integral can be written like this. So integral H dot, closed integral H dot dl is nothing but integral A to B, B to 1, 1 to C. I took this as first point one, and this is point number two, and written this as A to B, B to 1, 1 to C, C to D, D to 2, 2 to A equal to A. Okay, next, K is a surface current normal to the path. So I use instead of I, it is K into dW. Okay, similarly here, integral A to B, it is a tangential surface. This is A to B. Okay, this is a tangential surface which is nothing but parallel to the boundary. this AD as well as BC, which is nothing but a perpendicular component, say normal component. So H tan 1 del W plus H n 1 del by 2 plus H n 2 del H by 2. Okay, substitute this. This is del H. Okay, height of this is del H. If I am taking this as plus, you have to take tan 2 as minus. Okay, similarly, normal component also, one side if you take plus, another side minus. Flux is entering, flux is leaving. Okay, cancel these four terms, HN1 del H by 2 minus HN1 plus HN2 minus HN2. You'll be getting only H tan 1 del W minus H tan 2 del W. Take del W outside. This del W and D W is same. Cancel this del W and DW. We'll be getting H tan 1 minus H tan 2 equal to K. In vector form, we can express the above relation by cross product. Okay, instead of K, we are having just AN 1 2 into K unit vector, multiply with unit vector. Instead of H, we know that B equal to mu H. H tan 1 equal to B tan 1 by mu 1. Similarly, H tan 2 equal to B tan 2 by mu 2. You'll be getting this equation. Let's consider the special case that the boundary is free of current. Okay, boundary is free of current, we have to consider 0. Okay, for this K, consider 0. Now H tan 1 equal to H tan 2. For a tangential component of B, similarly, I replace H tan with B tan 1 by mu 1 and H tan 2 equal to B tan 2 by mu 2. Finding B tan 1 by B tan 2 equal to mu 1 by mu 2. Mu 1, it can be expressed as mu 0 into mu r 1. Mu 2 equal to mu 0 into mu r 2. Cancel mu 0, mu 0. Final result is mu r 1 by mu r 2. So from 15 and 16, it is clear that tangential component of HR continuous at the boundary with the condition that boundary is current free. Next, let the field makes an angle alpha 1 and alpha 2 with normal to the interface. In terms of angle alpha 1, alpha 2, we can write the relation as tan alpha 1 equal to B tan 1 by Bn 1, tan alpha 2 equal to B tan 2 by Bn 2. Substitute here, tan alpha 1 by tan alpha 2. Equation number 17 by 18, it gives like that. As we know that Bn1 equal to Bn2, because flux is one side, flux is entering, another side flux is leaving. Bn1 entering, Bn2 leaving. Okay, anyhow, flux will be same, only the direction only it reverses. Okay, so Bn, substitute Bn1 equal to Bn2, cancel this 2. Our answer is tan alpha 1 by tan alpha 2 equal to B tan 1 by B tan 2 equal to mu R1 by mu R2. Consider the interface between air, it is medium 1, and soft ion, medium 2. For air, mu r1 equal to 1. For soft ion, let mu r2 equal to 7000. Okay, substitute in this final equation, b tan 1 by b tan 2 equal to tan alpha 1 by tan alpha 2 equal to 1 by 7000. That is mu r1 divided by mu r2. Mu r1 is 1. Okay, mu r2, it is 7000. Okay, next, torque, the general equation, T equal to R1 into F1. There are two torques produced here. Okay, consider two equal and opposite forces applied at two different points, P1 and P2. The net forces is zero. There is no translation. The net torque, T equal to R1 cross F1 plus R2 cross F2. But since F2 equal to minus F1, substitute F2 equal to minus F1 here. T equal to R1 minus R2 into F1. Then magnetic moment. Having found the torque, dt equal to I into ds plus b. Then scalar magnetic potential and vector magnetic potential. The relation between scalar electric potential and electric field, E equal to minus del into V. Defining the scalar magnetic potential such that H equal to minus del Vm. Finding del cross H, del cross, instead of H, substitute this minus del Vm. Then the other Maxwell equation involving the magnetic field must be satisfied, del dot B. Okay, instead of B, substitute B equal to mu naught H. So mu naught, for H, it is minus del into Vm equal to 0. Multiply these two, del square Vm equal to zero. This is nothing but scalar magnetic potential. Then vector magnetic potential del dot B equal to zero. So vector magnetic potential. So the divergence of curl of any vector field is zero. Listen here, del dot del cross A, divergence of curl of any vector field. A means a vector. Okay, A is a vector. So del dot del cross A equal to zero. In other words, you can write del cross del dot A also zero. Okay. This leads to the definition of magnetic vector potential B equal to del cross A. This is nothing but compare this equation. Del dot B equal to zero. If you compare this, we will be getting just B equal to del cross A. B equal to del cross A. Now H equal, we know that B equal to mu naught H. Okay, substitute B equal to mu naught H equal to 1 by mu naught. Substitute mu naught H equal to del cross A. I want to find H equal to 1 by mu naught into del cross A. Okay, and Ampere's law become del cross H equal to J equal to 1 by mu naught del cross A. Next, the equation of vector potential del cross H equal to J equal to 1 by mu naught del cross A. As a vector identity, del square A can be written as del into del dot A minus del cross A. Del dot A equal to 0. We are therefore left with del square A equal to minus mu square J. The relationship between B and H. The total current in the general medium, which consists of some of the bound and free currents. Final results, B equal to mu naught into H plus M. Then inductance. Okay, inductance, when a coil of N turns carrying current I, the flux is produced by it. This flux links with each turn of the coil. Thus, a total flux linkage of the coil having N turn can be written as N phi. It is Weber Tesla. So the flux link with the coil is proportional to the current flowing through it. The ratio of flux linkage to the current produced that flux is called inductance. It is denoted as L. It is measured as Henry. So finally, we'll be getting for self inductance L equal to N phi by I into H. Then inductance of solenoid. Consider a solenoid of N turn. Let the current flowing through the solenoid I and length of the solenoid L, the cross section A. From the result, H equal to Ni divided by L ampere per meter. Total flux linkage equal to N phi equal to N into B into A. Substitute B equal to mu H. N into mu H A. So inductance of solenoid, I can write as L equal to mu N square I A divided by L H. Okay, inductance, then a solenoid inductance for a long solenoid having turn density N and core permeability mu, the magnetic flux density as a magnitude B equal to mu N I. So mu into for small n, it is capital N by D, is put is mu N I by D. Assume that equal flux densities through N identical turns, lambda equal to N phi equal to N into B into S. Is equal to mu N square IS by D. Next, coming to the mutual inductance. In this case, current in coil 2. Okay, this is a coil 1. This is coil 2. Number of turns in coil 1, N1. Number of turns in coil 2, N2. Current I1 is passing through coil 1. And for I2, here no current is flowing here. So the mutual linkage between the coil 1 and 2 is found through lambda 12 equal to N2 phi 12 which is nothing but N2 integral S2 B1 to DS2. The mutual reactance between coil 1 and 2 is defined as lambda 1 2 divided by I1. And this is a mutual reactance M21. Look at here, this is a coil having n number of N1 turns. No current is flowing in this coil 1. In a coil 2, the number of turns N2 and the current I2 is flowing. So it, mutual reactance M21 equal to lambda 21 divided by I2. Okay, self inductance L1 and L2 are L1 equal to N1 phi 1 divided by I1 and L2 equal to N2 phi 2 by I2. These are the self inductance of coil 1 and coil 2. Then mutual inductance of coil 1, that is M equal to N2 phi 1 2 by I1 equal to N1 phi 2 1 by I2. As a coupling coefficient, K equal to M divided by root of L1 L2. Okay, thank you all. No, sir.
Thank you, sir. You are going to give one for the brief introduction for the electromagnetic static field. Thank you. Next section will be start today, 2 o'clock, by Dr. Subhas Neeman. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I will stop recording, sir.
Yes.